off bucket lists. And kindness. And smiles.
And always.
The bald skeleton on the hospital trolley. That I think, unfortunately, is supposed to be me. Her last minute memories are ever so slightly different. Memories of almost constant ridicule would be a lot more accurate. Because that's just what you need when a life-threatening tumour's biting at your ass, isn't it? Take a saucepan of the usual unrelenting tumour pain. Add a nice jugful of daily sneering. And a cup of daily screaming insults. And then just a pinch of daily hissed insults. Because I look, how do my darling classmates put it? Rough. Yep. That'll be the tumour. But listeners, it gets even better. While this is going on, this is all being watched by the people who are supposed to be looking after me. And by my friends. There were a few times though when my issues just had to be spoken about. Aha! Time to bring out the barrel of bollocks! Excuses! Yay! Right. Let's look at a couple, shall we? Excuse one. The poor tormentor who only behaved as she did because she had a disabled sister.
Bart is bleeding. Oh yes. Excuse two.
The poor tormentor whose mother tells us, suffered, suffered
from emotional problems. Again, heart's bleeding.
And I started to notice something really, really strange about pretty much all of my tormentors. They were all, how do I put this politely? They're all either not the sharpest pencil in the box, or they had really, really good reasons to avoid mirrors.
And sometimes, if you're really lucky, both.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the Mingers and the Morons.
Seriously, if this was some sort of idea of a survival of the fittest indicator, God has got an amazing sense of humour.
But it gets even better. Because remember, all of this is just ignored. As I'm led to what looks to be my final destination, I remember how this all was. Last night, I was given a choice. I could either risk all the surgery and the treatment, or I could just
go home.
Great, nice and clear then. So last night, I made a decision. If I did survive this, I would be bloody sure that I made every chance the most of my second chance at life. mountains, the snow, silence. I was playing with my youth orchestra for 10 days in Canada. Oh, 10 days of long rehearsals, 10 days of chocolate muffins,
10 days of my host's sons wandering around in just their boxer shorts. Oh, honestly, I was seriously in heaven. But also, I'm still alive too. Despite what I and everybody else had thought. Despite tons of surgery, buckets of radiation and bloody painful permanent tube. So, I can just get on with it now with my second chance in life, right? Wrong! Because the tumour had very helpfully changed one thing irrevocably. It had stolen most of my peripheral vision. So, I am now labelled disabled. Lovely. The physical side of adjusting to partial sight, it's annoying, but you know, it's doable. I am, after all, supposed to be dead. What's really awful about being disabled is that you can be treated in all sorts of different ways that normal people just would not put up with in a million years. So really, it's the disabled that's so awful. But when I was 19, I didn't know that. So I just got on with things, with enjoying my second chance at life. Until that long ago night, in the new year, the beginning of the hell that would sum up what I would be expected to accept as a disabled person.
professional musician now.
Cheers.
Sitting in the sun, on the night of my final music college recital, I was so chilled out and relaxed, I didn't even notice the silent, shadowy stranger that crept up behind me and delivered my adult disability welcome pack.
the moron stranger on a family shopping trip, perfectly polite to my face, and as soon as my back is turned, demands, "Is your sister totally blind? Who lives and been wandering off?" Okayed with the dumb excuse, station staff who physically restrained me from getting onto a train because she insisted I had to be met by someone at the other end. Oh, there's that adult choice of movement again. The airport security bitch who demanded of my red-faced husband, "Can I search her body?" Because of course, as a disabled person, obviously I don't have a right over my own body, do I? Okayed by her manager. What's her first day? After all. Well, as I said, this was worth surviving for, wasn't it? Slowly, the memories of that New Year's night begin to return. A New Year's clubbing night, out partying with my mates. A nice enough bloke who asked me to go for a drink with him at a place he knew. Memories of a dark hallway and the click of a key locking the door. Memories of the tearing off of clothes and the desperate, silent fight fueled with rage and hate on both sides. Memories of the frenzied flight from a dead-eyed monster. Memories of a locked door that somehow opened. Not the first attempted rape on a person. Disabled or not. But is it really that unbelievable that this monster had seen the way it was okay for me to be treated and had used my disabledness as a chance to force the unacceptable? The noose of disability continues to tighten. His demonic laughter echoes through the years. Hooray for the mingers and morons! Hooray for our chocolate teapot disability law with no consequences whatsoever!
Treated like rubbish. Simple, no-nonsense legislation and a simple but watertight legal model that both define disability discrimination in the law would not take much. But it would give people like me more than a cat in hell's chance of getting justice when the disabled noose tightens for me yet again. I'm not naive enough to think I can teach the world to sing. I'm just demanding that our society punishes people when they choose to sing out of tune because someone is disabled. Stand with me, because nobody is safe from disability. One drunk driver, one unexpected diagnosis, and you are me.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to have like a half hour interval, then we're going to come back and do the second act of the performance, which is our song. So we'll see you all in a little while.